This video is primarily to my fellow watchers, those of us that are enthusiastic and looking forward to the coming of Christ Jesus to take us home. The Lord has given us some really exciting signs here lately, any of which could have climaxed in a rapture of the church. What I wanted to say to you is remind you of what Paul said, that God is not slack concerning his promise, as some consider slackness, but he is very long-suffering and patient, that as many as will hear the word will come to him. He is very merciful. When I realize that that's his reason for it, and I know that I would have had no chance but for his mercy, it kind of gives me a little bit of perspective. The watching is, on the one hand, very exciting. I mean, we just saw a sign in the heavenlies, Revelation 12, literally played out in front of us, well, literally over our heads, which the world largely missed. I think that was very exciting to see that. I know that there is no way that these things would have come together, these planets and stars and all that would have come together for anything short of the hand of God to make it happen. That was exciting, and there were so many that missed that, that missed the sign, and I think missed the significance of the sign. You know, it rings in a new age that is about to come down on us, and it's the age of Christ's millennium reign. And I think that's exciting for us to be watchers. On the other hand, we can get obsessed, and we have to be careful to maintain a balance. I'm just acknowledging the human spirit. We get exhausted. And sometimes even a watcher will have to step back, you know, and spend some time with the Lord and not lose sight of the big picture. When you get event-focused, you can get to the point to where whatever you're doing is all about that one event. And, you know, it's like putting together a puzzle. You get to focusing on one particular piece that you're missing, and you get to where you don't even notice any of the other pieces and where they go, because that one piece is right there at the forefront of your mind. We humans have a tendency to have trouble maintaining a balance. History is full of it. We swing one way and then we go the other way. I'm old enough that I remember hellfire and brimstone preaching. And then I saw it, you know, and that was way to one extreme. And then, you know, I remember coming down into the more recent years, God is love, God is love, God is love. And it ignored his justice. It ignored the fact that he is righteous and that he cannot abide sin. And there's a happy balance in there that Christ is. But we have a hard time finding our balance. We have a tendency to go to one extreme or another. And it's not just you and or me or, you know, believers. It's human nature. Human nature swings to extremes and has trouble finding the balance. So, as I say, you know, when it seems kind of disappointing, I mean, I would have loved to have went seen the Lord. I am so excited about it, I can't hardly sit still. But on the other hand, you know, if he is patient, not willing that any should perish, as Paul said, then I can do no less. I have to, you know, look at it the way he does And Paul did say that, you know, to live as Christ and to die as gain. To die as gain is much easier because you can receive it and you're done. And with the rapture, you don't even have the pain of death to deal with, but which is doubly exciting, maybe even triply exciting. But to live as Christ is our call, and Christ came to sacrifice himself. If there is a sacrifice that we can make that may in some way help, you know, toward the point of bringing in, you know, those last few that will believe before the rapture takes place. And of course there'll be a whole new harvest in the tribulation, but there are some more that aren't going to endure the tribulation because, you know, because of the Lord being patient and waiting and giving them time to come in. And, you know, if this is what he's chose to do, he's our leader and our master, and we'll bow to his will. It also, on a note that's not nearly so nice and pleasant, it also gives opportunity for those whose seed has fallen into rocky ground and things get rough and they wither away. Scoffers will multiply in the end days. The scripture is very plain about that. And the more they hear the message, it is easy to turn to a critical way of thinking and acting. And on that, brethren, I would tell you to be careful not to let that, not to take it personally. It seems aimed at you, but the master is the one that gave you the message. You are the messenger, and don't take it personally. It's really, you know, their real problem is with the Lord. And they get to scoffing and they end up, you know, setting aside the most important thing, which is Christ. Christ said that he makes all things manifest. And those who don't really trust in him, he'll make that manifest too. He will also give them, you know, room to repent. You know, some of them may harden their hearts and never repent, and some of them may have to face hardship and even tribulation. All we know is, you know, the Word tells us that we have to follow the Lord, and the Lord is merciful. He's given us a little more space of time, and we got to work while there's still day, even if it's twilight and the daylight is fading fast. We still, you know, we still can get some work done. We still can reach out, and we'll do it because it's in our hearts to do it. So don't lose heart. You know, sometimes the days of awe turn to the days of awe shoot. For those folks that think, you know, I hear so many times that no man knows the day nor the hour. I've heard it put as no man can know the day nor the hour. Scripture doesn't say that. Scripture says no man knows the day nor the hour. That was a present tense statement that was made 2,000 years ago. And some folks like to keep it as an ever unchanging truth. It is a temporal truth. In the time that the Lord said that, it was true. But on the other hand, the same God that said that also told Daniel that men will run to and fro and knowledge will increase. And he wasn't talking about technology and a better way of living. He was talking about the same knowledge that Daniel had been inquiring about, which is, Lord, what's going to happen next? What's, you know, the hidden things of God was what Daniel was interested in. And God was talking pretty largely about the same thing, that, you know, it's going, the knowledge as people seek the Lord and as they search His Word, the Holy Spirit will reward their diligence and teach them things, and knowledge will increase. Jesus, just a few verses down from where He said, no man knows the day nor the hour, not even the Son, He says just a few verses down, to watch, for you know not what hour your Lord may come. So that kind of indicates that by the time that it gets closer to it, it may be down to just a few hours that we don't know about. Often people can get things turned around. Jesus said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And there were people quoting it, do unto others as they do unto you. They kind of changed some things with that. And it isn't what Jesus said. People have a tendency to get carried away with things. There are two kinds of truth. There is eternal truth, and there is temporal truth. And it's all true, but temporal truth changes with perspective. It is regulated within the dimension of time. And with time, there is a past, a present, and a future. And there will come a time in the future when every man will know exactly what day and what hour the Lord came, because He did it. It's already done. It's a historical fact. Now, whether or not they accept it or believe it is another thing. It's not going to always be that no man knows the day nor the hour, because at some point it will have been fulfilled. And the promises of God that are to be fulfilled are done within the time, within the time stream. It will take place in such a way that, you know, it's done. Anyway, I kind of feel like I'm rambling on at this point in time, so I'm going to quit. But like I said, brethren, you hang in there. There may be some disappointment. On the other hand, it means that we have some more time available that we can be of use to the Lord here and now. And we don't want to miss any opportunities. We don't want to have any regrets. And realize that those who, you know, some of them are just plain wore out and have to step back. And it doesn't mean that they're not looking for Christ anymore. It's just meaning that they're looking for Christ so intently has taken a toll, and they need to take a bit of a holiday from it. They'll still believe in Christ coming, but it isn't something that, you know, they're hanging on. And anybody that does do that, you know, it's like anything else. We can take it to an extreme where it's unhealthy. And then there's those that, you know, are scoffers and will turn against the Lord. And according to what Scripture says, the harder things get, there will be more and more who turn against the Lord and against those that honor His name. So, you know, don't take it personal. Hang in there. God is faithful concerning His Word. My thing is, look to Christ. We'll be with Him shortly. But while there's daylight, don't lose heart, brethren. We love you a big bunch, and God bless you in your endeavors. Bye-bye.